We are up for a crazy Atlantic hurricane season. It may be even worse than that of 2005, the year that brought us Hurricane Katrina. That one took 1,392 lives and cost the country over $100 billion. Experts predict there will be between 17 to 25 total named storms. Some of these storms are about to become hurricanes, with winds reaching over 100 miles per hour or higher. We're already seeing storms sweep across the country, bringing dangers like tornadoes, flooding, and hail. You gotta thank the El Niño Southern Oscillation, or ENSO, for this. This complicated term has to do with El Niño and La Niña, the two giant forces that basically shape our world. Normally, winds in the Pacific Ocean blow west along the equator, moving warm water from South America towards Asia. This warm water is replaced by cold water rising from the depths of the Pacific. But during El Niño and La Niña, this usual pattern is messed up. El Niño is the warm phase of the ENSO cycle. During El Niño, the equatorial winds weaken, causing warm water to shift back towards the west coast of the Americas. This means less cold water rises to the surface. The weather in northern parts of the US and Canada become drier and warmer because of it. But there are wetter conditions in southern states. In the Atlantic, El Niño weakens hurricane seasons, and it ramps up hurricane activity in the central and eastern Pacific. In Africa, it brings more rain to East Africa, but less to Southern Africa, West Africa, and parts of the Sahara. La Niña is the cold phase of the ENSO cycle. During this phase, the westward winds along the equator in the Pacific are stronger than usual, and they push more warm water towards Asia. And because of it, colder, nutrient-rich water rises to the surface along the Americas' west coast. These colder Pacific waters push the jet stream northward, giving us drier weather in the southern US, but wetter and colder conditions in the Pacific Northwest and Canada. La Niña also brings warmer winters to the southern US and cooler than normal temperatures to the north. La Niña usually calms hurricane activity in the Pacific, but intensifies it in the Atlantic. In 2023, El Niño was in charge, and it took most storms up before they got to the US. But this year, we've switched to La Niña, and this lady brings us colder water in the Pacific and a pattern that lets storms move a little farther west and reach the Caribbean. And when they get there, they can easily move into the Gulf and affect Florida and other states. The upcoming intense Atlantic hurricane season also has to do with a strong monsoon season in West Africa. It creates moisture and waves off Africa's coast and can travel along the Atlantic and spur hurricanes. The Atlantic hurricane season runs from the 1st of June to the 30th of November, and most activity happens between mid-August and mid-October. Since the 1950s, tropical cyclones have been given names to make it easier for meteorologists to inform the public about them. You're more likely to remember that Leslie is coming than Hurricane X34D is on the way, right? So there are 20 names on the alphabetical list this year, from Alberto to Beryl to Valerie and William. Let's hope it won't get as terrible as the Galveston hurricane. The most fatal natural disaster in US history hit Texas in the year 1900. A Category 4 hurricane smashed into Galveston, demolishing over 3,600 buildings with winds over 135 miles per hour. It took the lives of between 6 and 12,000 people. One of the reasons it became so fatal was poor communication policy. Days before the disaster, it was clear to a professional weather forecaster that the storm was moving west. But the Weather Bureau in Washington predicted it would go over Florida and up to New England, which was way off. The Bureau was just 10 years old then, so hurricane science in the US wasn't very advanced. Cuban scientists were excellent at tracking storms because their region is so prone to them. So they knew it was heading towards the Gulf of Mexico. Unfortunately, the director of the Weather Bureau was so jealous that the Cuban forecasters were better than the American ones that he cut off the flow of information from Cuba and made it difficult for local forecasters to issue warnings without going through Washington. In the days before the storm hit, the chief observer in Galveston began to suspect that Washington's forecast was wrong and tried to warn the city, but it was too late. The hurricane left Galveston in ruins. After this hurricane, the Weather Bureau started improving communication, both internationally and within the U.S. The officials in charge are doing everything possible to improve forecasts, support the people, and help the affected areas recover more easily after the hurricanes hit. They're going to try new forecast models to predict tropical cyclones getting stronger, help emergency and water managers prepare for potential flooding, and protect people and infrastructure. Coastal weather buoys in the tropical Western Atlantic and Caribbean have been upgraded, and new drifters and sail drones, underwater gliders, and a lightweight drop sonde will provide real-time data. There are also some things you can do to ensure your safety before, during, and after a hurricane. If you live in a hurricane-prone area, Florida, Georgia, and the Carolinas, you must always be prepared before the high storm season. Make up a family disaster plan that will outline your actions during an emergency. Map out several evacuation routes in case your primary one is blocked, and decide on a meeting place if you get separated. You can arrange drills to teach family members how to shut off water, gas, and electricity, and even make sure the youngest knows how to call emergency services. Pack a disaster kit that will be ready to go at a moment's notice. It should include essentials like food, water, a first aid kit, and flashlights to last at least 72 hours on your own. You can buy a generator to make sure you have electricity in case of a power outage until the power returns. Keep it in a secure place, away from rain and rising water, with proper ventilation. You're also going to need self-powered radios and flashlights. If you can, add a safe room to your house that's strengthened to withstand high winds with reinforced concrete ceiling, floor, and walls. Make sure you have enough canned and non-perishable food and bottled water for at least 3 days. When the storm is about to hit, head north to get away from it, where it will be much weaker by the time it gets there. It's much safer to keep your family and pets together away from the storm than trying to ride it out at home. Try to go in one car if possible. Always follow local evacuation orders, especially if you're in a mobile home. Fill up your gas tank and give yourself plenty of time to get out. Never leave your pets behind. Debris, floodwaters, or flying objects can be dangerous for them. If you're staying put during a storm, you need a safe spot for you, your family, and your pets. This place shouldn't have any windows or skylights. If you're hiding at home, close all interior doors and secure the exterior ones. Quickly find an interior room with strong walls and no windows, like a bathroom or a closet. If your home isn't safe, look for a community shelter. Get to your shelter at least 2 hours before the storm hits so it doesn't catch you outside. Bring a battery-powered radio with extra batteries for updates every 15 to 30 minutes. Never leave your shelter even if it seems calm, as conditions can get worse quickly, especially if you're in the eye of the storm. For extra protection, lie on the floor under something sturdy, like a table. Don't use electric appliances, phones, or showers during the storm. Don't leave your shelter until you get the official all clear from the authorities. Be careful. There will be many hazards outside.
Rocks rolling down the slopes of a rumbling volcano, pushing other bigger rocks on their way, and eventually tumbling down into the ocean in a humongous cascade, causing a wave the height of which the world's never seen before. This is what might happen if the Helena slump of the Hawaiian Big Island falls off into the water. The Kilauea volcano is far from dormant. The latest eruption occurred in 2018. Its eruptions are usually accompanied by earthquakes of different magnitudes. And with each quake, the magma rocks on the slopes of the volcano shift down. These rock formations are called slumps, and the Helena slump is the most notorious of them all. In 1868, the shift of this slump caused a tidal wave rising as tall as 60 feet. But what's most troubling is that some 110,000 years ago, a landslide here led to one of the most powerful earthquakes ever, which in turn led to a mega tsunami of over 1,000 feet in height. Scientists are worried that such an event may repeat in the future. If that happens, the wave might engulf the whole of Hawaii and easily reach both North and South American coasts. Geologists are quick to reassure, though, that a landslide like this is unlikely to occur anytime soon. It's just too early for that. But when it finally does, the consequences will be catastrophic. Have a nice day! Yellowstone National Park in the western USA is world-famous for its dazzling views, and especially the colorful Grand Prismatic Spring at its very heart. But we should all stay aware that Yellowstone is, first and foremost, an enormous caldera, basically a slumbering supervolcano. The difference between a regular volcano, like Kilauea from earlier, and a supervolcano is that the latter is thousands of times more powerful. Imagine an eruption spewing tons of huge rock and rivers of hot lava, pumping out clouds of ash that make countries stop air travel for weeks. And now multiply all of this by 1,000. This is what a Yellowstone eruption would look like. At first, a huge area in the middle of the national park would shake, crumble, and then blast upwards in a megaton explosion. Lava flows and magma rocks would cover the area of about 40 square miles, roughly half of Washington, D.C. But the greatest danger is the volcanic ash. The ashen plume would rise miles above and get carried by the wind in every direction. Since the eruption would be far from ordinary, the spread and damage would also be much greater than usual. The ash is thick and heavy, so it would cover a vast area in a blanket, destroying crops and even buildings. Worse still, it would spread in the air and block out the sun, leading to a drastic drop in temperature and an artificial winter. Even regular volcanoes can lower temperatures worldwide by a few degrees. A supervolcano may potentially cause a new ice age. Luckily, the chances of Yellowstone supervolcano erupting in the near future, or at all, are extremely low. There have been only 3 of those in the history of Earth, and there's no evidence such a disaster should repeat. Scientists estimate the probability at 0.00014%, which is lower than the chances of an asteroid wiping us all out. Speaking of which, if dinosaurs could talk, and were at least still alive for that matter, they'd tell you that asteroid threat is as real as it gets. Scientists at NASA say they've tracked 90% of all near-Earth asteroids of significant size, and none of them are a matter of any concern. But there are still the other 10% in the great unknown. What's more, asteroids can change their line of flight because of the pull of other celestial bodies and eventually turn our way. Lucky us! Now, if an asteroid big enough, like a mile across, hits the Earth, it will first cause an explosion powerful enough to erase a dozen big cities in a matter of seconds. Then, the impact will raise a cloud of dust and debris that will block out the sun, just like the ash cloud from a volcano, and cause a centuries-long winter on the whole planet. But even if it falls into the ocean, which is more likely, a resulting wave will rise several miles high, washing coastal cities off the face of the planet. But at least there won't be a new ice age. Although scientists are pretty sure there's no such threat in the near future, it can't be ruled out completely, and humanity needs at least 5 years to prepare for this event. If a big near-Earth asteroid suddenly changes its course and turns right toward our planet, we won't stand a chance against it. Disaster movie, anyone? A much more probable calamity, though, rests right beneath our feet. It's the San Andreas Fault in California. The fault has been ready for rupture for years now, and scientists estimate that an earthquake along this line is likely to occur in the next 3 decades. And when it happens, it won't be nice. They expect a magnitude of 8.0, which is comparable to some of the most devastating quakes in history. It's all the more dangerous since California is home to some of the most populated cities in the western U.S., including Los Angeles and San Francisco. High-rise buildings are common there, and they're particularly vulnerable against underground shakes. The San Andreas earthquake might cause a whole lot of damage, both to cities and countryside. In the worst-case scenario, the ground might break apart, destroying buildings, farms, and changing the landscape altogether. Still, scientists believe that the probability of such a quake is only 7% for the next 30 years. So, there's a rather big chance, 93%, that we'll never see that in our lifetime. Yet, there's another earthquake hazard not so far away from the previous one. The megathrust in Chile. The country sits right above the subduction zone, an area where two tectonic plates meet and go one beneath the other. At the place of their meeting, stress is accumulated because of their continuous movement, and once that strain is too much, a major earthquake occurs. Chile has experienced a lot of quakes in the recent years, and scientists are worried those might be preparing the area for a really big one. They believe a great earthquake is due to happen before the end of the century, and it might be devastating to the coastal area. Even smaller quakes caused tsunamis that flooded the west coast, and a huge one like that is likely to raise a wave of incredible height. On the bright side, Chile now knows to prepare in advance for the coming natural disasters, and geologists are pretty sure people will be able to evacuate before the earthquake strikes. In September of 1859, astronomer Richard Carrington was looking at the sun and suddenly saw a bright flare on its surface. He made a note of it in his records, but only realized how important it was a couple of days later. The energy from that flare reached Earth and struck it directly, causing northern lights to appear above Cuba and burning telegraph lines all around the world. This was dubbed the Carrington event, and it was a solar storm. Such storms hit the Earth fairly often, but none of them were so powerful as the Carrington event, neither before nor after. But in 2012, astronomers registered a similar solar flare whose energy nearly hit our planet once again. If it had been just a week earlier, we'd have been in big trouble. Today, humanity relies on electricity in almost every aspect of life, and a powerful solar storm would mess with the electromagnetic field of Earth a lot. All electric appliances would either shut down or short-circuit, and huge transformers powering basically everything would go out of order for good. It would take years to repair them, and the cost of such a massive blackout would count in trillions of dollars. The worst of it is that science is almost unable to predict solar storms, and even if we could know about them in advance, we'd be powerless to stop them. The flare happens in a matter of seconds, and it takes about 8 minutes for the particles to reach the Earth's atmosphere, causing the disturbance. The power outage would come a bit later, in a day or so, when a massive cloud of plasma gets to our planet. At the moment, there's no protection against solar flares, and the chances of one powerful enough to cut all of our electricity in the next few years are quite high, about 12%. The only good thing about all this is that we now know of such a possibility and can at least prepare in advance. Hey, don't forget to pack some underwear and socks. You'll always need those.
Our planet has known terrible floods, powerful tornadoes, destructive hurricanes. Those dangerous natural disasters are familiar to us. Just picture this. Winds howling through the atmosphere at about 500 miles per hour, and they can stick around for weeks. These insane winds have the potential to damage the ozone layer, making our Earth a hostile place for life. It's not some wild Netflix dystopia. These are real-life hypercanes. A hypercane is a hypothetical extreme tropical cyclone the likes of which we've never known. To kick off a cyclone, the sea surface temps have to hit around 122 degrees Fahrenheit, basically hot enough to sear a rare steak. It's tough to imagine, especially since that's nearly 22 degrees hotter than the highest ocean temperature ever recorded. Yep, the hottest ocean water ever was recorded in Kuwait in July 2020. What could cause such a serious increase in temperature? A powerful comet or asteroid impact, an eruption of a supervolcano, or a large underwater eruption? There's even a theory that a series of hypercanes could have sped up the demise of non-avian dinos after the infamous asteroid impact. An important difference between a hypercane and any present-day hurricane is that a hypercane would rise as far as the upper stratosphere. That's up to 25 to 35 miles over the surface of our planet. Meanwhile, present-day hurricanes only go as high as the lower stratosphere, up to 6 miles above Earth. It would make a dramatic, catastrophic difference, but we'll talk more about it later. Hypercanes could gust to 600 miles per hour. For comparison, the most powerful recorded tropical cyclone in terms of maximum sustained winds was Hurricane Patricia. At its peak, it reached a speed of 215 miles per hour. This speed pales in comparison with that of a hypercane. Can you imagine how much destruction such a natural disaster could cause? Should they ever form, hypercanes will also have an enormous lifespan. They could range for a couple of weeks, if not more. Extremely low pressure inside hypercanes would support massive storm systems the size of North America. At the same time, hypercanes could be as small as 15 miles across. Such relatively tiny formations would lose their strength in no time after wandering into colder waters. On the other hand, the waters after a hypercane could hypothetically remain hot for weeks, hot enough for more hypercanes to form. Since a hypercane would reach far up into the stratosphere, there would be a real chance it could damage Earth's ozone layer. And it would have devastating consequences for life on our planet. The ozone layer absorbs some of the harmful radiation from the sun, preventing it from reaching the planet's surface. Let's just hope to never see a hypercane in our lifetime. Another potential disaster that could seriously harm Earth could be the activity of our very own sun. A massive solar flare. Few natural disasters can wreak as much global havoc. A solar flare wouldn't destroy buildings like a tsunami or earthquake. It wouldn't end lives in the same way an asteroid or a supervolcano would. But if the worst comes to the worst, it would destroy the entire electronic infrastructure of our planet. Recovering from the consequences of this catastrophe would cost trillions of dollars. An incredibly powerful solar flare could cause loads of infrastructures to fail, including communication, medicine, banking systems, and transportation. Earth would be left without electricity for a long time, and people wouldn't be able to reboot the already broken power grids. Water supply systems would be out of order. There would be no food in supermarkets. In 1859, people in different parts of the world woke up in the middle of the night because it was so light outside, they thought it was already morning. The skies were illuminated with colorful auroras. They showed up even in the regions where no one had seen them before, like the Bahamas, Hawaii, or Jamaica. Telegraphs got electrically charged, even though they were disconnected. Fires started in many regions. In other words, the consequences were already catastrophic, even when technology barely existed. Imagine the avalanche of problems a solar flare could trigger today. Then there are gamma ray bursts. You can't come across this kind of radiation in your everyday life. A gamma ray burst occurs when two neutron stars collide when a massive star collapses. Gamma rays could turn into a serious danger to our home planet. If a gamma ray burst happened close to Earth, it would likely rip our ozone layer away. And you already know how crucial this layer is. Plus, gamma rays could create ground ozone. This kind of ozone could seep into the ocean since it's water soluble, and that would lead to a mass extinction of marine life and plants. According to some theories, if a gamma ray burst occurred within around 200 light years away from Earth and its jets were pointed directly at us, our planet would be vaporized. If the distance was greater, but still in the Milky Way, the resulting radiation would sterilize all life on the side of the Earth pointing towards the burst. Another catastrophe that could potentially destroy our planet might be a super eruption, an eruption of a supervolcano. Yellowstone Park is located on top of one of those. The last massive eruption in that region happened about 664,000 years ago. The next eruption might be due anytime soon. Luckily, at the moment, there's no evidence that the supervolcano is waking up or getting ready for an eruption. But if it did happen, a massive column of lava and ash would shoot up into the air to a height of several miles. The volcano would keep pumping ash for days on end. But the most dangerous consequences of the eruption for all living creatures would be ash fallout. Buildings and trees would collapse under the weight of this dense substance. In just a couple of days, a 10-foot layer of ash would cover the territory of 50 miles around the center of the eruption. After the ash got into the stratosphere, the temperatures would start to drop all over the world. The eruption would most likely be rich in sulfur, an effective sunblocker. So soon it would get so cold that there would be no summer in the entire world for a few following years. It would be hard for animals to find food and clean water. Earth could also encounter a wandering black hole, a region in space where gravity is so powerful that not even light can escape its clutches. At the moment, the nearest to us black hole is around 1,500 light years away. Seems like there's nothing to worry about. Well, until you find out about wandering black holes. Now things definitely get creepier. If such a black hole entered the solar system, Earth would be doomed. Recently, for the first time ever, astronomers have found a solitary wandering black hole in our home galaxy. This space traveler is 7.1 times as massive as the Sun and is now 5,200 light years away. Scientists discovered wandering black holes before, but those were in other galaxies. This one is the first to pop up in the Milky Way. Giant sinkholes could also swallow entire communities. For example, when one of such sinkholes opened up in the city of New York in the summer of 2022, it pulled a parked van into the earth. And it wasn't the only sinkhole in that area. Local inhabitants reported around 4,000 sinkholes all over the city between July 2021 and June 2022. This kind of problem is also very common in Florida, and it's much more serious than it may sound. Sinkholes open all of a sudden, pulling down everything and everyone that happens to be nearby. Sinkholes appear all over the world. They're totally unpredictable and form without warning. Luckily, experts know what causes them. In some regions, there are vast areas of groundwater. But during droughts, this water dries up, which creates large, empty caverns. After heavy rains, the surface over such a cavern is likely to collapse, creating a sinkhole within minutes.
Ah, Kiev, you've been dreaming of getting here for years. Getting out your trusty camera, you start taking pictures of the cathedrals, aviation museum, and the Dnipro River, when, without warning, there's an enormous boom behind you. Turning around, you see something towering in the distance. It looks like a gigantic explosion. Uh-oh, time to leave fast! In June 2020, what the people of Kiev were looking at was an anvil cloud, a rare storm formation in the sky. Forming when strong air currents carry water vapor upwards, the air expands and spreads out as it hits the bottom of the stratosphere. It pushes the dense cloud into the cool anvil shape you see, and sometimes it even gets to be a mushroom. Anvil clouds produce some of the most dangerous lightning of all storms, one that's called a bolt out of the blue. This lightning strike seems to magically come out of the blue sky with the storm being many miles away. This type of bolt comes from the top of the anvil and can be 10 times more powerful than a typical lightning strike. People got so frightened after witnessing a giant cloud just 60 miles away, thinking something terrible must have happened. The locals had pictures of the large billow on social media before officials could explain what was going on. Authorities managed to calm everyone's fears by informing them it was nothing more than a natural phenomenon, and a beautiful one at that. Before dissipating, these clouds typically stay in one area, regardless of how strong the wind is. Touring around the northern tip of Queensland, Australia, way away from those creepy crawlies, it's time to take a break and relax at the beach. Getting comfortable, you notice a great big shadow passes over you, then another, and yet another. Looking up, this weird weather is simply stunning. The clouds are called morning glory, a very rare type of cloud that almost seems to roll across the sky, looking like a massive tube. These clouds can measure up to 600 miles long, even appearing in large groups as well. This phenomenon is the result of an updraft pushing through the cloud, creating a rolling appearance, while moist, cooler air at the back causes them to sink downward.
southern India between July and September 2001. People witnessed one of the strangest weather phenomena in recorded history. The rain was red. What many would have thought to be a typical rainstorm left them shocked. The color was bright enough to stain clothes. There were other colors too, such as green, yellow, brown, and even black. In the middle of a monsoon, red rain started to fall, and did so periodically for several weeks. Researchers have found this unusual rain is stained either by dust or algae, so don't try to catch any on your tongue. Scientists aren't entirely sure how the algae got all the way up there. This does make events like this a little unsettling. Like to take a bubble bath to relax after an exhausting day, but taking too long to fill the bathtub? Problem solved. Head to any coastline after a big storm and take a dip. Foamy tides aren't native to any one place or location. They can be formed anywhere in the world. They're most likely to happen along rocky coastlines, like the coast of San Francisco, Northern Ireland, or the Mooloolaba, Australia. Each coast has differing conditions forming the seafoams. If you scoop up seawater into a glass and look at it closely, you'll see it's full of tiny particles. Many things like plants, chemicals, and lots of salt and minerals create the perfect formula for foam. When powerful currents and wind mix it all together, we get something that resembles a cappuccino top floating on top of the water. When freezing temperatures hit orchards in Michigan, all kinds of unusual things happen. Like ghost apples. No, they're not going to scare you at all. But if you plan on sneaking away one winter to find one, be warned. Everything has to be perfect for this to occur, and it's going to be freezing cold. This is actually a rare weather phenomenon caused by having the apples freeze where they are with rain coating the fruit in a thin layer of ice. The apples then thaw and leak out like applesauce, leaving just the beautiful ice shell behind. The Catatumbo River in Venezuela might be the most electric place in the world, with nearly 300 storm days per year. The lightning storms are so consistent, they're predicted for 3 months in advance. During the wet season in October, you might see 30 lightning flashes in a single minute, a truly shocking experience. With each bolt having the energy to power a single light bulb for 6 months, the impressive display could power all of Venezuela forever. At sunset, strong winds flow around the three surrounding mountains, forming storm clouds over the water. As the water droplets of humid air collide with ice crystals from the cold air, it produces the static charges that cause the lightning storms nearly every night. If that wasn't bad enough, some storms have lightning above them as well. Try to take a picture of this one. Jellyfish lightning sprites are electrical discharges high in Earth's atmosphere. They're associated with powerful thunderstorms, but they have nothing to do with rain. These sprites occur 30 to 50 miles up in the sky, in the mesosphere. Artificial lights at night make it a lot harder to see this faint lightning. If you spot one, it'll look tiny, but can be well over 30 miles wide. The red sprites are a type of cold plasma discharge above a thundercloud. They're the balance of the lightning charges between the storm clouds and the ground below. Don't try to find this type of donut at your favorite bakery. It won't be there. Snow donuts are one of the rarest meteorological sights to see, with perfect weather conditions needed just to create them. Found in any snow-covered mountain area, like the Rocky Mountains, the wind, temperature, snow, ice, and moisture have to all work together for us to see these phenomenal rings. A thin layer of wet snow on the ground. Under that layer, ice or powdered snow. Then, a strong enough breeze to roll the donut down a hill, just like a snowball. Once it stops rolling, it can be the size of a baseball or as large as a car tire. It all depends on how strong the wind is. A newly formed snow donut won't stay around for very long, so hurry up with that camera.
Watching the sunset over the horizon, the beautiful purples and pink overhead are nothing compared to the three suns you see in front of you. Wow, since when did Earth get three suns? These phantom stars sometimes appearing beside the sun are called sun dogs. Maybe they're called that because they're kind of dogging the actual sun? Sun dogs often appear as colored areas of light at the same height above the horizon as the sun. They're mostly observed on a ring or halo, where ice crystals best reflect the light. There are also moon dogs that appear alongside the moon and are formed by lunar light passing through ice crystals, though these aren't seen nearly as much as their daytime partners. Taking photos in the wild, you finally found the perfect spot to take that dream shot. The crystal clear water, the pines, the mountains, and the flying saucer. Wait, a flying saucer? Oh, aliens are here! You might be thinking this if you saw a saucer-shaped cloud. I'm not even going to try to pronounce their name, though. Put that on the screen, please. Wait, just kidding. It's Altocumulus lenticularis. Aren't you impressed? These are really just unusual cloud formations over mountaintops. When moist air flows over a mountain, a wave is created if the temperature difference is perfect. As the air passes through the wave, evaporation occurs, and a series of these clouds may form into an oval shape. Not aliens at all. Whew! The sky is falling! The sky is falling! Well, people who have experienced these clouds say they look like they're coming down from the sky. Mammatus clouds look like giant white lumpy marshmallows, but it might be hard to toast these ones. These weird fluffy clouds can extend hundreds of miles in any direction, remaining visible for short periods at the bottom of anvil or other thunderstorm clouds. The strange bubble shapes are formed from turbulence within the storm itself, creating an uneven cloud base and appearing anywhere in the world. Mammatus clouds form when moist air sinks into dry air. The air must be cooler than its surroundings, cooled with ice, or be heavy with water. Ah, a purple sunset. You must have seen one of those at least once in your life. Normally, it's nothing ominous and has to do with the way light travels. The light that the sun produces is white. When it goes through a prism, you see light waves of different colors, from red and orange to blue, green, and indigo. Light normally travels in a straight line if there's no obstacle in its way. The shorter light waves, including blues and purples, are scattered easier when they meet with those obstacles, like molecules and aerosols in the atmosphere. Because the sun is low on the horizon at sunset and sunrise, its light has to pass through more molecules that scatter the violet and blue light. The colors that your eyes pick up, then, are yellow, orange, and red. But with the right conditions, you can see the gorgeous purple sky. Sometimes purple sky appears for much scarier reasons. It can be caused by hurricanes, wildfires, or dust storms. The concentration of vapor in the air increases, and the light scatters more than usual. Dust, a setting sun, and low cloud cover all contribute to this natural show, too. The sky turns orange and red at dusk if there's still enough light. Then it gives off pink hues, which mix up with a dark blue sky above. Now, do you remember what happens when you mix pink and blue? You get the color purple. Not every hurricane makes the sky turn purple, and trying to predict if it's going to happen is like trying to forecast a rainbow. Still, people reported several major hurricanes made the skies turn purple. Now, green skies might look just as spectacular as purple ones, but they actually also scream danger. They're usually there to tell you a thunderstorm, hailstorm, or a tornado is somewhere nearby. The unique color is a result of yellow sun rays getting mixed with the blue light coming from storm clouds. So you're enjoying a nice day by the ocean with a fresh breeze in your hair, when suddenly you notice the water starts retreating from the beach at a huge speed. This is a sign for you to start running as fast and far away from the beach as you can. This most likely means that a tsunami is on the way. A quick reaction maximizes your chances of survival.
Now, if you notice the sea level is rising, but it doesn't seem too extreme, it could be another sign of an approaching tsunami. It happens in 40% of cases, and the incoming water is the first tsunami wave. The next one, way larger and more dangerous, usually follows in about 10 minutes. Another thing about tsunamis is that they like to arrive with some loud sounds. People describe them as thunder, the sound of a locomotive, a helicopter, or just a loud boom. Do you see a channel of choppy water on the beach? It's in your best interest to stay away from the water. There might be a rip current under the surface that can be extremely dangerous. Sometimes waves hit the shore in a weird way, which forms these rip currents. You might see a strange break in the waves, or an area with a different color than the rest of the water. Random bits of seaweed going in all directions is another rip current warning sign. If you happen to find yourself caught in a rip current, try to stay afloat, but don't try to go against the current. You'll only waste precious energy. Scream for help and try to float your way along the beach. Once you break out of the current, swim diagonally to the shore. The next time you spot conically shaped clouds in the sky, remember, it's a good time to start looking for some shelter. If it just stays like that, a severe storm is on the way. But if a cloud of that shape starts spinning around, it means it's about to transform into a tornado. If you have bees nearby, they can save you from big trouble one day. These hard-working little guys get more active than usual when they feel like a storm is on the way. They speed up to collect more nectar before it hits them, and once they're done with it, they'll always come back to the hive 10 to 15 minutes before heavy rain, even when there are no obvious signs of it coming. Their secret is super-sensitive hairs on the back that can pick up electrostatic buildups from storm clouds. For centuries, people have noticed that animals act weirdly a couple of days before big seismic events. Dogs can't start barking, cows halt their milk, and toads, rats, and snakes leave their homes. It looks like animals can feel smaller initial shockwaves that humans don't even notice. Scientists have tried to find some legit explanation for it and run endless tests and experiments. But so far, they're still on their way to explaining this mystery. Can you smell ozone in the air? When a thunderstorm is on the way, it's the most distinct and pungent smell you can pick up. An electrical charge of lightning sets it free from higher altitudes. The other, more pleasant smell of rain is petrichor. Rainwater wakes up molecules on plants, trees, concrete, and asphalt. Their aroma spreads all over the place. You can even feel that smell in your own mouth. All those positive ions in the air that a lightning bolt sets free gets mixed with ozone and your saliva, and that's how you get that bitter metallic taste. When lightning is about to strike, you might hear bizarre crackling, buzzing, or vibrating sounds coming from metal objects nearby. Your palms may begin to sweat, and then you can feel your hair stand on end. That's a clear call for action, and that action is to run for your life. Positive charges are going through your body, trying to reach toward the negatively charged part of the storm. Trust me, you don't want these charges to meet. If you see no shelter that you can reach fast, try to make yourself smaller than the objects around you. Drop down your umbrella and stay away from wire fences, metal pipes, rails, and other metallic objects. And don't lie flat on the ground. It's likely wet, which means it's a great conductor of electricity. If you suddenly notice crevices in the asphalt next to your house, it could be a sinkhole warning sign. Inspect your house on the inside. Does that door begin to jam? Or maybe there's a gap where the walls meet the ceiling. Uneven kitchen cabinets and drawers, slanted floors, stairs that begin to slope, water leaking after every rain, and displaced moldings are all signs that a sinkhole is about to open. To find out if it's definitely a sinkhole and how dangerous it is, you gotta consult with an engineering company. If you find a sinkhole that's already there, you gotta stay away from the sinkhole area. Fence or rope it off to make it less dangerous for others. You'll need professional help to fix it. Some volcanoes scream when they're about to erupt. Small earthquakes, which often happen before, produce a hum.
It's mostly non-audible to human ears, but sometimes it reaches a frequency that lets you hear it as a strange rumbling or hissing sound coming from the ground. This noise is known as a harmonic tremor. With some volcanoes, it's the sound of magma bubbles vibrating when they're going through crevices in the crust of the Earth. But it's not always like this. If scientists manage to understand what exactly causes these volcanic screams, they could create a limited early warning system for volcanic eruptions. If you're out in the wild, pay attention to the water in creeks, streams, and rivers. If its level is quickly falling, even if it's raining, this might be a sign of a nearing landslide. And if you hear a faint rumbling noise or unusual sounds, like boulders knocking together, it could mean debris is on its way to you. It's a sign to head to safety immediately, like right now. Hey, ever heard of a fire rainbow? Yeah, me neither. How about a circumhorizontal arc? Didn't think so, but just so you know, they're one and the same thing. At first glance, it looks like a painting, or like a rainbow-colored splash in the sky. Despite the name, they have nothing in common with either fire or rain. This phenomenon happens on rare occasions when the sun shines through a particular type of ice cloud formation. The rainbow halos are just as unique. Again, a specific type of ice crystals and clouds needs to be present for the surface of the Earth to bend light from the sun into a perfect ring. The same thing can happen with moonlight. The only difference will be that moon halos are usually white, and sun halos can be rainbow-colored. When visiting regions with high altitudes, you may be one of the lucky people to stumble upon penitentes. They're basically naturally formed ice spikes. For them to be formed, they need a really cold and elevated environment where the air is dry. The sunlight turns ice directly into vapor rather than melting it into water. And that's why these blades of snow and ice start to pop up on the surface of the Earth. As cute as they may be, they can end up as tall as 15 feet. Now, what happens when small individual droplets of lava meet the wind? Pele's hair, basically. Let me explain. The word Pele comes from an ancient Hawaiian symbol for volcanoes. Whenever the wind picks up little drops of lava, it stretches them into hair-like strands, similar to the process of glass wire creation. These delicate strands can stretch as far as 6 feet. On rare occasions, it can rain without any clouds. But does it really? Let's look at the science behind this rare phenomenon. It's sometimes called a sun shower, just because it looks like the rain is falling straight from the sun. Let's be clear though, there is no way rain can ever come down directly from a star. Rain clouds are at a bit of a distance from that specific location. With sun rays being angled, the clouds become out of sight. Add a little wind to blow the rain in your direction and ta-da! You get sun showers. Located in Bolivia is a place called Salar de Uyuni. It's the largest salt flat in the world. It's also the home of half of the world's lithium, which is a crucial component for making batteries. But what else is so special about this place? Well, whenever the rain season comes, it turns this piece of flat land into a perfectly reflective mirror lake. What comes to your mind when you hear about the Blood Falls? A horror movie? Well, they are merely a series of waterfalls located in one of the driest regions of Antarctica. They emerge from an underground lake filled with a special kind of bacteria. These little organisms use sulfates as fuel instead of sugars, which makes them very intriguing for scientists. The water contained in this lake is so full of iron that it basically just rusts when it meets the air. Hence, the reddish color of the waterfall, which also gives it its trademark name. Okay, we all know the song, but it's not really made up. There is actually such a thing called a desert rose. It's not a plant, though, but a unique form of the mineral gypsum. It develops in dry, sandy places that can occasionally flood. This constant switching between a wet and dry environment lets the gypsum crystals emerge between grains of sand, trapping them and forming a rose-like shape. Ever heard of the Eye of Sahara? Scientists are still trying to figure out how it was formed. You can only see it if you fly above it, but it's basically a naturally formed dome that dates back to approximately 100 million years ago. And no, I wasn't around then. It has a rough diameter of 25 miles and consists of a bunch of concentric rings. The biggest one, or the central area, measures about 19 miles in diameter. Astronauts were some of the first people to notice it, and it's been studied ever since. In fact, even to this day, when landing in Florida, they know they're almost home when they see the Eye of Sahara. One of the most beautifully colored trees in the world is located in the Philippines and Indonesia. It's called the rainbow eucalyptus. It got its name because of its bark that switches colors and peels away as the tree ages. The bright green bark is the youngest, as it contains a substance called chlorophyll, usually found in leaves. It then switches to purple, and then to the color red. And finally, it turns brown as it grows and loses the chlorophyll. Now, don't be tricked into thinking that's a whole forest. It's one single tree. And no, it's not some sort of optical illusion either. Let me explain. Underneath that soil, there is a complex network of roots that connects around 47,000 tree-like shapes you see above the ground. It's called the quaking aspen. Some of these trees are among the oldest and largest organisms in the world. Now, here's a good destination for all travelers, or maybe not so good after all. The most lightning-stricken area in the world, according to recent data released by NASA, is Lake Maracaibo in Venezuela. Out of all the days in a year, 300 of them feature thunderstorms in this location. What makes this area so unique, though, that storms happen so often? Well, it's because where cool mountain air meets the warm, moist breeze and generates electricity over the lake. The Eternal Flame Falls are located in upstate New York, near the Canadian border. In this region, there is a tiny waterfall with a big secret, a spark about 8 inches tall. Turns out there's a natural gas seep that provides fuel to the flame behind the waterfall. The waterfall provides enough coverage so that it stays lit pretty much every time. Hikers do enjoy to relight it if they see that it's been blown out. This phenomenon is actually quite common, but this one gained more popularity because it is younger than most. And it looks very good in pictures, let's be honest. I've heard of yellow sand, white sand, and even black sand here or there. But I've never heard of green beaches until now. Papakolea, also known as Green Sand Beach, is located in Hawaii and is one of the few beaches in the world that features green sand. The unique coloring comes from olivine rock that was formed when a nearby volcano erupted. Actually, in Hawaii, all the volcanoes are nearby. Move over, green sands, because some of the other beaches around the world can even glow at night. And it's completely natural. The culprit? A little thing called phytoplankton, or microalgae, as they're sometimes called. They're basically little plants that contain chlorophyll and need sunlight in order to live and grow. Most phytoplankton kinds are able to float in the upper part of the ocean, where the sunlight can still reach them beneath the water. When the phytoplankton gets agitated by the movement of waves and currents, they emit light, which looks like some glow during the night. These special microorganisms are found on beaches in a lot of places around the world, such as the Maldives, Puerto Rico, and the Everglades. At the base of a mountain located just outside of Afton, Wyoming, is a little river called the Intermittent Spring. There are only 3 of this kind in the whole world, but what makes this little string of water so mysterious? Well, the fact that it starts and stops every few minutes. Scientists have yet to pinpoint precisely why this happens. They speculate that it's basically just a siphon effect that happens deep within the ground that causes the river to just start and stop so often. Should you ever be interested in checking it out, be sure to do so in the late summer, as that's when the intermittent spring is most active. Do you see the irony here? You can only see the spring in the summer? Okay, I'm done.
You feel some rumbling from below. No, it's not your tummy. It's low and ominous. You look up and see strange lights hanging above the ground. They look like shimmering balls of light hovering high up in the sky. Your throat goes dry and you gulp. That's what they call the earthquake lights. This phenomenon is poorly understood, but witnesses say they've seen it in different shapes and sizes. It could be in the form of light balls, sheet lightning, streamers, and a steady glow in the sky. Soon after, a strong earthquake follows. Scientists can't explain why those lights appear, and they don't always do either. Some believe that's a reaction of underground gases released into the atmosphere. Sure enough, an earthquake begins. But lucky you, it's not as strong as you expected. The ground is shaking, but you even manage to keep your balance. It stops as abruptly as it began, and you walk home. On the way home, you see a flash and hear a whip crack. Lightning has struck a lone tree near where you just stood. It's caught on fire, and there's a column of flames rising to the sky. Still no rain, and the pillar becomes taller and taller. Have you heard of such a thing as a fire tornado? These phenomena occur when the wind is caught in a circle close to the ground because of the difference in air pressure. Such mini tornadoes are usually easy to notice. Small rubble, dust, sand, and leaves rise into the air and start flying in rapid circles. But then, if there's a source of fire nearby, the funnel can catch it and blow it stronger, like bellows. The flames go round and round, reaching ever higher and eventually creating a swirling, blazing tower. Luckily, fire tornadoes are short-lived and don't normally cause much damage. But don't try to hide from the storm under that tree. You can find this unusual plant in Florida and in some parts of the Caribbean coast. Externally, it doesn't look special at all. A gray trunk, green leaves, and fruit similar to small apples. What you must remember is never to pluck these apples and never stand next to the tree, especially if it's raining. This is the manchineel tree, which is considered the most dangerous in the world. Its trunk, bark, branches, and fruit contain poisonous juice. One drop of this corrosive acidic liquid can harm your skin a lot. The tree can secrete this juice, and if you accidentally touch it, you risk burning your hand. When it rains, water droplets fall on the tree and mix with the poison. Water can also bounce off the bark and get on your skin. That's why you shouldn't stand nearby either. There are almost no other shrubs or mushrooms growing around. Animals avoid these trees, and people don't chop them and don't pluck the fruit. You can't make a bonfire from their branches. Burning wood emits poisonous smoke that can damage your eyes. Locals know this tree well, but tourists and travelers might accidentally get harmed. That's why most manchineel trees are marked with paint or have a warning sign. In western Venezuela, locals living close to the Catatumbo River aren't afraid of lightning because they see it almost every single night. It starts at around 7 o'clock and doesn't stop until dawn. The everlasting Catatumbo lightning did once stop for a few months, from January to March 2010. It was probably due to drought, or maybe the charge ran out. In 1991, a scientist suggested that the phenomenon happens because of cold and warm air currents meeting in the area. Another theory is that the lightning could be due to the presence of uranium in the bedrock. Not all lightning happens inside clouds. There's a rare phenomenon called a dirty thunderstorm. The lightning happens above a volcano. The most famous is in Japan. It erupts almost every day and spits black clouds high into the air. So it's super scary volcano clouds plus lightning. Whoa! Regular lightning happens during a storm when ice crystals bump into each other. In a dirty thunderstorm, bits of volcanic ash collide, create friction, and spark up the sky. In the hottest and one of the driest places on Earth, Africa's Danakil Desert, temperatures often rise above 120 degrees Fahrenheit. The out-of-this-world landscape has many active volcanoes and geysers that spit out toxic gases like chlorine and sulfur. The vibrantly green, electric blue, and yellow waters are all rain and seawater warmed up by magma. One wrong step here, and you'd be gone for good. This happened in June 2009. People in certain areas in Japan left their homes after a heavy downpour, only to find fish, frogs, and tadpoles everywhere. Fields, roads, lawns, and rooftops were littered with these aquatic creatures. One man was shocked to see 13 carp on and around his truck. Apparently, he stopped to count them. No one knows for sure where the bizarre rain came from, But the most popular theory claims that a powerful waterspout picked up all these creatures. Then it carried them through the upper atmosphere and dropped the animals on the unsuspecting people below. And now, welcome to Abraham Lake in Canada. It's completely frozen. You step onto the transparent ice and look down at what lies beneath. No fish, just some mysterious frozen bubbles. They look like small clouds frozen in ice, or jellyfish who forgot to pack a winter jacket. There are thousands of these little bubbles made up of methane. But don't try to dig a hole in the ice to touch it. Methane is highly flammable. It's created by methane-producing bacteria that eats leaves, grass, insects, or any other organic stuff that gets into the lake. When the methane touches the frozen water, it turns into tens of thousands of frozen little balls. When the ice melts, they burst open and sizzle. Similar lakes can be found near some shores of the Arctic Ocean. There, the size of the bubbles can reach several times the size of hot air balloons. Beautiful for sure, but not exactly safe. The next shocking lake is in Indonesia, the island of Java. You come to a majestic volcano, overgrown with grass and trees. The volcano seems to be asleep, but smoke is pouring out of it. You climb to the summit. Exhausted, tired, sweaty, you're ready to cool off. Nice work, you made it to the top. You look into the mouth of the volcano. No boiling lava, just a beautiful, bright, turquoise lake down there. It looks like an oasis. Perfect time for a refreshing dip. You run down and get ready to jump in. But that's not water, that's acid! Sulfurous gases get into the lake from under the volcano. The lake itself is full of metals. When the gases touch them, they form that beautiful turquoise water. I mean, acid. Better head back to the nearest village, rest, and come back at night when it's cooler. In the dark, the lake seems to glow. Right above it, you see light-filled, exploding little clouds. The sulfurous gases rise out of the lake, combine with the air, and flash bright blue. Still, don't get too close. The sea turns sinister red, and no living being can survive in it. Must be some dark magic. In fact, it's tiny algae that spread uncontrollably, giving the water this specific tint called the red tide. They have toxins that destroy sea mammals, birds, and turtles, as well as creatures that feed on them. For humans, contact with it ends in breathing problems or seafood poisoning. Sometimes even huge ships sink in the open seas for no visible reason. That reason is often the pockets of bubbles that underwater volcanoes produce even while they're sleeping. Those productive magma factories are hidden under 8,500 feet of water. When they wake up, they act just like land volcanoes, and they can cause destructive tsunamis. This tree looks like a bottle. No wonder it's called the bottle tree. It grows in Namibia and attracts many tourists. But don't get too close to the tree because it's one of the most dangerous on Earth. Milky juice flows inside the trunk. It's highly toxic to the human body. On the bright side, though, the trees have beautiful pink-white leaves with a red core. There's a tree growing in Western Australia that was once used as a prison. A cell for criminals existed inside the Boab prison tree for a long time. People were usually kept there temporarily, just for one night. After that, they were taken to their final destination. The prison was built more than 1,500 years ago and has been perfectly preserved to this day. Tourists visiting this place can sneak a peek inside.
When we think of active volcanoes, one region comes to mind: the Ring of Fire in the Pacific Ocean. Three-quarters of Earth's volcanoes sit within this belt. Compare the area to Australia, which doesn't have any volcanic activity. The old continent of Europe is also calm. Or at least, we like to think so. Can you guess what the most active volcano in Europe is? If you thought of Mount Etna on the island of Sicily in Italy, you were right. The volcano has erupted about 200 times and has been far from sleeping in recent decades. The last time this happened was in August 2023. The highest mountain in the Mediterranean is half a billion years old. But in Iceland, there is a much younger volcano. It sprang into action on the 10th of July, 2023. In the afternoon, three fissures appeared in the ground on a peninsula in the southwest of the island. This was at a base of a small mountain peak. Its name means little ram in the local language. The volcano spewed molten lava high into the air. There were also gas plumes in the area. But the scientific community wasn't surprised by the event. They already knew about the volcanic area that stretches between the cities of Reykjavik and Keflavik. Its name is hard to pronounce. Hey, I want to buy a vowel. It had already erupted during the previous two summers. This activity came after 8 centuries of dormancy. In the days leading up to the latest eruption, seismologists, the scientists who study earthquakes, recorded over 12,000 tremors. When the ground opened up in July, the fissures were over 1.5 miles long. The following morning, 2 of them closed. All the lava was now coming out of the last fissure. It grew into an elongated cone, the simplest shape of volcano we are all familiar with. The lava soon filled a large crater. It grew almost 100 feet tall during the first week, and it is still growing. On the night when the eruption started, lava spread out in all directions. Its cinders set ablaze the dry moss in the vicinity. Local authorities closed off the surrounding area. There were toxic gases from the volcanoes and smoke from the burning moss. Firefighters flocked to the area. After a week, they proclaimed the area safe. Visitors soon came to witness the birth of Europe's youngest volcano. This form of tourism is quite developed in Iceland. People come from all over the world to watch active volcanoes. The land of fire and ice is home to more than 130 volcanoes. Some 30 of them are active. Now, I know what you're thinking right now. Is volcano tourism safe? In Iceland, it is. The country's authorities research and constantly monitor all of the hotspots. The island is dotted with several dozen seismic stations. These help researchers accurately predict future eruptions. And emergency services are accustomed to these sorts of events. They can quickly cordon off danger zones. This is what happened in 2010. A volcano in the south of the island, the name of which everyone struggled to pronounce, erupted. It spewed out a plume of steam and ash that was 7 miles high. This wasn't a fun time to be an air traveler. Winds carried the enormous plume southeast toward northern Europe. Many countries closed their airspace for several days for safety reasons. The volcano erupted in March, but the Earth was shaking from January the same year. So seismologists knew that an eruption was approaching. When it comes to the continent's youngest volcano, the tourist infrastructure is already there. Visitors can leave their cars at a designated parking lot. Then they go on a 5-hour-long trek. This leads to a viewing deck. Tourists are so close to the epicenter that they can feel the heat haze from the crater. The sight is the most impressive at nighttime. Safety is never a concern. Scientists regularly chart out hazard maps that outline the borders of lava fields. This way, visitors who stick by the rules are never in harm's way. More than a week after the eruption started, a section of the crater collapsed. Lava flowed downhill west of the volcano. This majestic, smoldering hot river is slow-moving lava. Scientists categorize it as an A'a type. The term is Hawaiian. It describes basaltic lava that has a rough and brittle surface. The flow is composed of broken lava blocks that are called clinkers. They fall off as the substance flows. This reveals red-hot areas. The cooler sections of lava are gray and black in color. When it moves forward, it produces a distinctive sound like shattering glass. Nearly a month after the eruption of the new volcano, we got aerial footage of an interesting phenomenon. A tornado formed directly over the lava flow. This occurs due to the high temperatures in the area. When the conditions are right, a column of heated air can easily turn into a mini tornado. Scientists observed a similar event happen during the 2018 eruption of Mount Kilauea in Hawaii. The lava fields of Europe's second largest island tell the story of the creation of Iceland. It sits above the place where the North American and Eurasian plates meet each other. Tectonic plates are huge, rocky chunks of Earth's most outer layer. There are roughly 20 of them. They rest on a partially molten layer of rock. All the lava we see on the surface starts its journey here. You could say that these plates float on molten rock. Their boundaries are unstable. So when two plates grind past each other, they release tremendous amounts of energy.
The formation of volcanoes is one result. These are places where the molten rock travels upward to the surface. Iceland began to form some 60 million years ago. The tectonic plates under the ocean drifted apart. Enough lava piled up on the surface to create solid ground. This ancient rock is under the waves today. As new lava reaches the surface and cools down, it pushes the old rock away from the center of the island. That's why the oldest parts of Iceland aren't 60, but only 16 million years old. The country's active lava fields are young in geological terms. Some of them are under 1,000 years old. Scientists consider the island a hot spot for volcanoes, pun intended. Nearly a third of the basaltic lava that reaches the Earth's surface in recorded history came from Icelandic eruptions. Fissure swarms, like the ones before the 2023 eruption, cover 30% of the Nordic country. For this reason, only a quarter of the island is inhabited. Norse Vikings were the first people to settle in Iceland at the beginning of the 10th century. Nature threw them a loud welcoming party. Just a few years after their arrival, they witnessed one of the greatest volcanic eruptions in history. Vikings came from a region without volcanoes, so they had no clue as to what was going on. Today, Icelanders are used to such events. This is good because their homeland is entering a new era of volcanic activity. Volcanologists suspect that recent events are an introduction to decades of more frequent eruptions. The peninsula that is home to Earth's youngest volcano is just 17 miles southwest of Iceland's capital city. It's been dormant for a long time. Present-day eruptions there are a reminder that the natural processes that created Iceland are still ongoing. Recently, scientists discovered that there's a historical link between volcanic eruptions in the north of Europe and glaciers. Our planet went through at least 5 major ice ages. These were exceptionally lengthy periods when the average temperature on Earth dropped. The result was the expansion of ice sheets across northern Europe and North America. The last ice age ended some 10,000 years ago. Researchers are still trying to fully understand how these glacial periods affected volcanic activity. They suspect that the sheer weight of all that ice disrupts the flow of magma underground. When glaciers retreat, the pressure is lifted. This makes it easier for lava to flow upward to the surface where it bursts. So get this. Taylor Swift takes a flight from Los Angeles to Tokyo that leaves at 10 a.m. on February 20th. She's on the plane for 12 hours, but she lands only at 2 p.m. the next day in Tokyo. That's a 28-hour difference. So, how did this time warp happen? Well, it's all because of this wonky line. This is the International Date Line. You know, that imaginary line that slices the globe in half and decides who gets to celebrate the new year first? It's the Line Islands, by the way. But crossing this line doesn't just make you feel like you've stepped into a transporter. It actually changes your day. Cross from east to west and boom, it's 24 hours later. If you travel in the opposite direction, crossing the line from the western side to the eastern side, you go back an entire calendar day. Now, you'd think that the International Date Line would be a nice, neat, straight line in the ocean where the time zones switch. But in reality, it's as if someone took a ruler and said, "Let's make this complicated." The line zigzags all over the place, wrapping around islands and causing all sorts of head-scratching confusion. For instance, Big Diomede Island and Little Diomede Island are only 2.5 miles apart, but have a 21-hour time difference. And things can get a little more complicated depending on which time zone a country follows. For example, if you travel 659 miles across the date line from Baker Island to Tokelau, you must add 25 hours. In other words, that's one day and 1 hour. And if that doesn't sound weird enough for you, wait, it gets crazier. When it's 6 o'clock in the morning on Thursday in New York, it's still Wednesday night in American Samoa. Meanwhile, over in Kiribati, it's already Friday. Yep, we're talking about 3 different calendar days happening at the same time because of this one imaginary crazy line. This phenomenon occurs every day between 10 o'clock and 10:59 in the morning. So, why does the International Date Line look so ridiculous in the first place? Well, great question. Although these zigzags may seem completely arbitrary, they actually have a logical basis. It's pretty much a made-up concept based on the Earth's rotation. The Earth is always spinning, thank goodness, and it takes about 24 hours, or a day, to complete one full rotation. To keep things in sync, people took the Earth and divided it into 24 time zones, each 15 degrees apart. But what is the starting point for a day on Earth? Well, basically, people needed to figure out which of these 24 zones, or lines, would be the starting line, or the chronocenter. They needed a reference point, a line where they could begin adding or subtracting time as you move east or west. That line is what we now call the prime meridian. But here's the catch. Deciding where to put this starting line, the prime meridian, is totally arbitrary. The idea of establishing a line where days begin and end goes all the way back to at least the 1300s. Back then, mapmakers were doing their own thing, picking their own east-west dividing lines, called meridians, which, by the way, is just a fancy Latin word for midday. Without a universal standard for when a day officially started or ended, sailors on long voyages just had to wing it, figuring out how to handle the time they were gaining or losing along the way. So, in 1884, people decided to organize this whole mess. 25 nations gathered at the prestigious International Meridian Conference in the United States with one big goal: to decide on a line that would serve as the official prime meridian. Finally, like it or not, they were determined to create the international date line that the whole world would accept and would follow from that point forward. The prime meridian was established in Greenwich, England, and the international date line was placed on the opposite side, running through the 180th meridian. Well, sounds simple, right? But that's when the nightmare really began. The chosen international date line didn't just wander through uninhabited areas. Oh no! It split some countries in half and created all sorts of chaos. I mean, if you divide the world with a completely straight vertical line, you end up with situations where half of a country is one day ahead and the other half is one day behind. Take Kiribati, for example. The country is primarily centered in the Gilbert Islands, which sits just west of the international dateline. However, in 1979, their territory got a little bigger with the Phoenix and Line Islands, which are way east of the dateline. Suddenly, Kiribati was straddling the international dateline. This created a bit of a headache for businesses. Folks on either side could only communicate by radio or phone for 4 weekdays a week. Now, to fix this quirky situation, Kiribati decided to skip Saturday, December 31, 1994, right off the calendar. So Friday, December 30th, turned into Sunday, January 1st, 1995. And just like that, New Year's Day came a day early. Woohoo! After that, the dateline moved eastward to go around the entire country. So the same thing that happened to Kiribati happened to other countries as well. For example, when they got to the Aleutian Islands in Alaska, yep, the line made another detour to include them. And when they got south of the equator, well, guess what? Another eastward bend to cover even more islands. And that's pretty much why the straight line started to get a bit ziggy-zaggy. This wonky line is designed to avoid land as much as possible, so there's less hassle when it comes to changing days. So, no, you can't stand between the international dateline, like having one foot in one day and the other in the next. But you can cross it by boat. In fact, some fancy trans-Pacific cruises even offer a time travel package for adventurous travelers who want to cross the line and jump into the future. Now, in the end, the international dateline looks this ridiculous because it was constructed based on a series of arbitrary decisions, historical quirks, and a whole lot of confusion. But it's not just because people organized it in the 19th century that there is no confusion regarding time zones today. Another thing that the prime meridian establishes is Coordinated Universal Time, the famous UTC. Now, UTC never changes for daylight savings time or anything else. However, in 1908, Canada decided to spice things up by creating daylight saving time, or DST. Their idea was to set the clocks 1 hour ahead of standard time to make better use of sunlight in the spring and summer and fall evenings. The idea was so brilliant that most countries jumped on board, but not everyone. Just look at Nepal. They have never ever used the daylight savings time, which means their clocks do not change throughout the entire year.
As you probably know, countries with large territories often have more than one time zone. Just like the United States, which has 11 time zones. Australia has 9, while India, well, India is a special case. Look, India is a big country with an area that stretches around 1,800 miles from west to east. So it should have 3 time zones in total. But they only have one. This means that the sun rises almost 90 minutes earlier in Dong in the Far East than in Guwahati in the West. And why do they have only one time zone? Well, basically, because they can. Just remember that the international dateline and time zones are invisible, artificial, and now you know, totally arbitrary. So, if a country wants to stick with just one time zone to simplify processes and business operations within its border, then hey, why not?